Hello viewers, I'd like to record a video here just to conclude my play of the game of Lutzen and my first play with the solo system, card system, and also, well, this is going to be essentially three parts to this video. The first is my experience of the Battle of Lutzen. The second will be about my experience with the hybrid of rules that I used to play this game, and the third will be about the solo system as which was indicated the play of the imperialist player in this game. So the first thing I can say about the Battle of Lutzen is a very interesting battle, more interesting than Breitenfeld, I found, because, as it indicates, it's a more balanced engagement. It's also very interesting because it's dominated by ditch here. Well, it's kind of like a double ditch. There's a road and with a ditch dug on either side of it, apparently by the Catholic Empire forces. And there's a gap here between the town and that ditch, and then there's the ditch ends here. So there's now the ditch is a major feature because for example for entering the ditch is not a problem for most units, but the cavalry and heavy infantry units, when they leave the ditch, they have to roll for disruption. And if a unit is disrupted, it loses a bit of its troop quality and even some of its strength points. No, that's incorrect. It just loses troop quality. Yes, but the point then is that the cavalry are not so good in shock. So it's and it also provides protection for people in the ditch. Not a huge amount, but some. So it's a major barrier for movement. It's a complete barrier for the artillery. So the Swedes manage to line up their artillery more or less along the ditch. They steadily moved it up, foregoing fire to move up their artillery, but they weren't able to get it over it. Consequently, what happened was that the Swedish heavy infantry came in front of their artillery at a certain point, so the artillery couldn't really support it. So the ditch was a major obstacle to the Swedish attack. It also, and the other feature is that the ditch ends here, but from here to here is an elevated road, and that is a greater chance of disruption for cavalry going across. And this river was automatic disruption, so the Swedes had great difficulty in. They got some cavalry across here, which were fought back by the imperialist cavalry on the wing, and they just then those cavalry were useless for the rest of the game. There was just essentially some cavalry sniping, because here you have cavalry with pistols, so heavy cavalry can charge. They can also fire as well at 1 hex range. So there was cavalry sniping going on there. And we had the heavy infantry, Swedish heavy infantry, having trouble crossing the ditch and engaging with support from their artillery here. And then on this flank, it looked like at the beginning of a Swedish success, they managed to clear out all the commanded musket units from here. And they're hoping to squeeze through the gap here. But the imperialist heavy artillery is here. And I reached the 1430 turn at the on the 1330 turn. No, it was 1230 turn, I think. Pappenheim came reinforced, so half of the reinforcements coming from the town about 20 miles away finally reached, and so there was a heavy mass of cavalry kind of waiting there for anyone who's going to squeeze through the gap. Again, if any of the infantry had moved up to dislodge the artillery there, the cavalry would just have swept down, destroyed them. And in the duel against the commanded muskets, although the commanded muskets only have one strength point, so as soon as they take a hit, they're gone. There's a lot of them, so they traded a lot of blows against the light infantry there, knocked out practically the whole wing of light infantry, just leaving behind the artillery and some cavalry. So essentially what happened was that the Swedes were stalemated on either side in terms of their cavalry, so they couldn't have an effect. And because of the ditch, their two lines of heavy infantry weren't able to, well, they got a bit congested as well moving up, so one moved across, but then it couldn't move any further because the Imperialists were there, so the other line was just waiting behind. They're too big to manoeuvre successfully, you know, to manoeuvre around, plus the ditch was a big problem. They were getting disrupted as they were going across, and it was looking like a close one thing. Finally, I stopped the game at the 2:30 because I didn't finish playing the turnout to conclusion, because essentially what it said was that, let me zoom in a bit. So at this point here, we had, this is the second line of Swedish heavy infantry come up. The first line was kind of like here, and it's just two of its units, two of its three units have just been destroyed. But similarly, they just destroyed some smaller, but still, you know, hefty Imperialist heavy infantry units there. And So I reached the point in this turn where it was just whoever got an activation first eliminated the other player's fellow first. And, you know, one side might have won on a technicality on how the sort of turn order goes. But essentially, just to illustrate for you what's going on here, is that... I don't know if you can see that, sorry, the light's terrible here. Let me try and get a bit closer. So, I'll show you here, I'll show you some of the hit markers. Look, you've got hit markers of 11 points. There's 8 on here. What you have is you have units, let me show you one there. This unit, for example, it has 12 musket fellows and 6 pike fellows in there, so that's 18 strength points. So, you know, we were getting hit markers of 13, 14, and that is just trading blows. So units lined up here against units lined here, they were just trading shots turn after turn. And it was all really down to, like, the number of activations. And the point is that when someone fires on you, you get to fire back at them. So... you know, each side was just, it was just attriting each other horrifically, turn after turn after turn. And that's what lost it, is that the Swedes couldn't bring their second line of heavy infantry up or bring their first line back to prevent them from being completely attrited away, whilst the Imperialists, they've even got some heavy infantry back there that they never brought in, so they even had reserves. So strictly I would have said that this was an Imperialist victory, because the Swedes are left with a smattering of cavalry here. They've got a fair few guns. These ones are disrupted, so they stopped firing. They actually lost some guns here. They were abandoned by their crews. But we had similar events happening to the Imperialist guns. So on the the Swedes have cavalry on this side, but they lost the infantry there. So at any moment, these could have burst through that gap, swept down here, swept away all of the gun crews, and, you know, quite decisively have left these fellows stranded. But as it happens, that's the turn I finished on. The last turn was a heavy fog turn. There's no firing. This turn was light fog, and the fog's going to clear here, but then we reach dusk. So according to the game instructions, both sides reached their army withdrawal level in this turn. So that's how we're going to end the game, essentially, as a draw. And that's how the battle played out, essentially as a draw, although I think it's kind of like a Pyrrhic victory for the Imperialists, because like I said, they've got their cavalry left, they've still got reserves left. The Swedes have some cavalry, but they're down to their last line of heavy infantry, and I don't see if there hadn't been that heavy fog and fog now, because with light, even with light fog, the cavalry can only move so far without getting a bit disrupted. Without that, those fogs and then the dust coming, this cavalry might well have made it through. They were just hesitant to do so because I was playing with the solo system deck. As an opposing player, I probably would just have flooded them through, and would have had some melee there. I don't know. These are heavy cavalry, but in the Simple Great Battle of History rules, you don't get counter charges. So if these charged them, they wouldn't get to counter charge back. They'd just have to take the brunt of it, and we'd see what would happen. So I mean, that would have been an interesting encounter that never happened. But the game was, and the battle really was still decided with the dreadful infantry and volley firing here. So that's enough about Lutz and the battle itself. Now, as for my hybrid rules, essentially what I ended up playing was, it wasn't like a simple great battles of history with like lots of extras from Lion of the North, which was kind of what I intended it to be. It was really just a melange of rules inspired by the Lion of the North rules and the Simple Great Battles of History rules, because I reached I worked everything out beforehand. Like I have a clash of arms, rear and flank protection. So I worked it all out. I translated, and the artillery and the musketry fire and the pistol fire, so forth. I translated it all from Lion of the North into Simple Great Battles of History style, and then I thought, okay, and then I decided I would use the movement chart from Lion of the North because it's got more details for things like this elevated road, which is a very important feature, and so forth, and the ditch, and then the gardens over here around Lutzen. So I thought I'd be using the combat and the sort of command system from Simple, and then the movement chart from Lion of the North. And I started playing that, and then, and I think, and I probably expressed it in the first video for this, and then I realized, hang on a minute, there's a significant difference between Lion of the North and the rest of the Great Battles of History series. And that is that the Great Battles of History series hits are taken as against troop quality TQ. So you, every unit is rated for its strength and its troop quality. And shock and fire combat are taken against troop quality. So you never really watch units attriting in strength, they just reduce in their quality and or morale and eventually like rout away. In Lion of the North, Richard Berg made that significant change because of the changing face of warfare, essentially the use of firearms. And I hadn't taken that into account, I hadn't really clocked that. So I was using the Simple Great Battles of History rules, which work on the Great Battles of History idea of hits against TQ. It didn't work with Lion of the North because what you have, and then, but then I was taking it against, so I was taking TQ hits and applying them against the strength of the unit counters, which is how you do it in Lion of the North. And it just didn't work because you have lots of very high TQ, like cavalry, like the Swedish heavy cavalry, but with very low strength. Like a lot of them are only 2 strength. So particularly here, they took a couple of what would have been TQ hits. I took them off as strength hits, and those units just evaporated straight away. So I had to go sort of rewind that cavalry fight here a couple of turns just to sort it out after I realised, okay, I'm going to do it different. So now I had to split things. So I said, shot combat will be against TQ and for disruptions, but fire combat is going to be against unit strengths. And that it was completely necessary to make it work as well once those heavy infantry units came up. So I ended up with a bit of a melange of rules. It worked out all right, but it essentially it was quite nice because it freed me up to say, okay, I didn't have to worry too much about I was playing a set of rules. I was playing my rules and kind of winging some of it on the fly. So it meant I could enjoy the battle using simpler elements from simple great battles of history that let it play quicker for me. Although I did use the a variant to that which someone had posted on Book and Geek, which gives commander activation or formation activation similar to the commander activation in great battles of history, because in simple you don't get momentum, but you can get seizure, which is their version of trump. I played another one where you've got momentum, and I needed to do that because I had in simple great battles of history there's no tracking of time, and I needed to track the time on account of the fog and reinforcement arrivals. And so I kind of reverted to more or less great battles of history version of that. So anyway, it was a great melange of rules that enabled me to play out this battle, I think, in quite a satisfactory way. I think it gave me a good impression of how, if the commanders had done what I did, how it would have turned out. Poorly for the Swedes, as it turned out. Poorly for the imperialists, merely because the main problem, I think, was you cannot withdraw these big double-length infantry units. They can kind of wheel, and tertios could about face, but you don't have tertios here. So once they're up against each other, they can't backstep or sort of wheel in reverse. They just have to stand there punishing each other until one or both evaporate from the field. So, yeah, so I had had a thought that, oh, if this hybrid was successful, I would post my rules conversion of Lion of the North into great simple great battles of history online, but I can't do that because it was too much of a melange. I think, the suggestions that I've done make for a doable battle, and it seemed reasonable to me. But I sort of couldn't, I don't think I could post it in great faith that other people would. It might be easy to pick holes in what I did. So now the last part of the video, I'd just like to speak a little bit about the solo system that, if you remember, is the system of card play for deciding upon an opponent's moves within solitaire play. Now, I'm not going to sort of describe the system as such. I think I might devote another video to that sometime, but I'd just like to comment on my experience of it, which was it was quite interesting because it kind of awakened me up to one thing. Essentially, what happened was, to start with, I was really enthusiastic of turning over the personality card, and I chose to do it on each activation. Normally, you might do it on each turn, but I thought for each activation we'll see what that commander does. Otherwise, say if I turned over aggressive, every activation in the turn would have been governed under aggressive. But I gave them a different indication each activation, and it worked out really nicely. I had because these the system is extremely Flexible is not the right word, but what it is it's not a rigid instruction. It's more like inspiration on how to interpret. Now let me say that differently. It's inspiration for moves essentially. So if I have if I activate a cavalry command on this wing here and I say now what could he do? There's several ways I could do it. It's very open how you use the system. There's several suggestions to do it, but essentially you would play a character type, see kind of what character is going to perform the move, and then you might ask questions and then answer the questions with a one of the question answering cards. So typically you would answer three questions, say would he do this very likely thing, would he do this not so likely thing, would he do this unlikely thing, and or you could just find one question, say now he's likely to do this, is he going to do it, and you could answer it with a card. I didn't actually use that because I to me that felt too much like randomization, and I don't really like in my I didn't want just what felt like a randomized opponent, so I used the personality more, and so it's okay. So I activate that force. So I've got the aggressive personality. So what would be an aggressive move? Or I might have the builder personality, and what would be a sort of build action for cavalry? And typically that was like if they were dispersed, I would combine them, recombine them together, withdraw them, so forth like that. Now I had some problems at a certain point in trying to think, okay, if I pulled up a scholar personality, what would a scholar do? But fortunately, the designer has provided extra sort of fleshing out of the characters, so I found that subsequently, and it enabled a more satisfying resolution of the decisions. But what I wanted to say about the solo system is what I found is that from my point of view at least, there seems to be yeah, okay, I'll just quickly put a light just to get some more light in this. Yeah, I think what I kind of found is that there's maybe two broad types of solo play, and one is that you play the other side as though as yourself, so both sides of yourself, and you say, what would I do in this situation? What is the best thing to do in this situation? And the other way is to for like a robot decision tree type thing, some card play, even dice rolling, some system to control what the opposite player does. And what that would mean is two different things because if I have this cavalry force here, and as me myself, I've played the Swedish side, I'm now playing the imperialist side, I'll say, okay, what would I do as the imperialist in this situation? So I'd look at the situation and take my move accordingly. Now, if I was using a bot or a card system or whatever, I don't generally they would say like, okay, these are your options. This is you turn over an option is selected, and then you have to interpret that option onto the game state. So you're not with that, you're not really governed by what's actually happening on the board. So it's almost like you have a type and you have to perform the type according to the situation. Whereas, as a human player, I just look at the situation and try to do what's best within the situation, within those capabilities. Now, I don't know if I'm expressing myself so very well, but I think what I'm trying to say is that with a system, it's kind of blind. It does what the system says, and you just perform that no matter what the actual state is on the board. Obviously, it might be informed by that, you know, in sort of general terms, like is enemy attacking or is enemy defending, and so forth. Versus a non-blind state, which is where I, as the player, take control. But the advantage of the blind state is that it gives you that kind of illusion or some semblance of an unpredictable opponent. It's going to do something you don't know. Now, but I'm uncomfortable with that because essentially I never really kind of suspend my disbelief and sit to feel like, oh wow, that robot played really well against me. It's almost as if you know, it's just like playing a real human being. I'm kind of like, no, it's just a bunch of randomized functions. I was essentially playing against a maths machine that you know, it had nothing. I wasn't playing. It wasn't playing a game. You know, it wasn't under the same kind of like stresses and strains as me. So, it doesn't. Normally, it doesn't give me that same satisfaction. As even though I have to sort of double hat myself the other way and say, okay, I'm the imperialist this turn. What do I do in the next turn? I'm the Swedes. What do I do? That way, I sort of feel quite involved. Whereas the other way, I feel involved. You know, win or lose, I'm kind of like it's not satisfying because it didn't. It wasn't involved. I was involved, but the robot wasn't involved. But this, I think. Actually, the solo system is a kind of like blends those two. It's maybe like a medium way between those two because what it is not a rigid system telling you what to do, and it is essentially inspiration for what to do. So, you know, the personality type of the turn is not a rigid set of rules of what to follow. It's kind of like, okay, you're trying to discover the move. Here's some inspiration, here's some more inspiration, here's some more inspiration. And if you like, you can just simple randomized function. Does he do this? Yes, no, or not. So to me, that this quite nicely straddles that gap between the uninvolved robot and the involved double-hatted human being. Because I am still having to make decisions and interpret what this says. So I'm not just blindly following, you know, I'm not just blindly implementing what a machine has chanted out. So I like it. But on the other hand, I did find that I kept reverting to type in that I would not draw a card because I kind of say, well, looking at this game state, I know what has to happen. And you know, that's the temptation as a solo player. You're kind of like, you play both sides, you say, well, obviously. He wouldn't do that. that would be a crazy move. And then one does one's own crazy move anyway. But I think you know what I mean. It's so because this wasn't the solo system wasn't a strict mechanism, it meant that I could sometimes drop it and maybe you know maybe quite arbitrarily, and then other times when I sort of couldn't be bothered to make a decision or wasn't the one wasn't immediately obvious, I would use that to help me. So occasionally I would find that I was kind of fighting against it because I would think, okay, that would be a silly move to make, but the cards seem to be telling me that that's the direction he's going into. And so if it was a rigid system, I would just have to do it anyway and accept it. But because it's not a rigid system, you know, I'm kind of like, I feel like I could ignore it and interpret it a different way if I don't. Now, you know, that's good or bad. It just depends on what you want. But I think I've chatted long enough and I'll post this video up and I hope it's going to use some insight into the Battle of Lützen. Struggles with trying to hybridize rules and also the solo system.